Full body dumbbell strength. Workout description: if you have trouble sticking with your exercise regimen, it might be because it is a drag to do the same old cardio or weight training split week after week. Please like, share, comment, and subscribe this video.
Click on Zombie Apocalypse.
I have found that to keep my clients interested and excited, I have to create new exercise routines on a daily basis. We may repeat exercises, but rarely do repeat whole routines. I want my clients to have fun and enjoy coming to my modest little garage gym. This little sequence is a full body dumbbell strength workout as well as a metabolic conditioning program. You can use it as an alternative or in addition to your regular workouts. It is a great workout for groups as well as individuals. Each exercise is done for 20 seconds and then you rest for 10 seconds. Do the first exercise for 4 intervals, then move to the second exercise. After you complete the first 2 exercises, you do 10 burpees. Then move on to the next 2 exercises and use the timing and sets as outlined above. Do 10 burpees after every 2 exercises as listed below. Seated dumbbell press overview. The seated dumbbell press is a variation of the standing dumbbell press and an exercise used to strengthen the muscles of the shoulders. The overhead press is a foundational movement for establishing baseline strength and building a completely balanced physique. Utilizing dumbbells as opposed to performing with a barbell will allow the individual to strengthen each side of the muscle equally. The exercise can be included in shoulder workouts, push workouts, upper body workouts, and full body workouts. Seated dumbbell press instructions: set up an adjustable angle bench to 90 degrees and select the desired weight from the rack. Pick up the dumbbells from the floor using a neutral grip, palms facing in. Position the end of the dumbbells on your knees and sit down on the bench. Using a safe and controlled motion, kick your knees up one at a time in order to get each dumbbell into place. Once the dumbbells are in place, rotate your palms so they are facing forward. Take a deep breath, then press the dumbbells overhead by extending the elbows and contracting the deltoids. Slowly lower the dumbbells back to the starting position. The arms should be roughly 90 degrees or slightly lower depending upon limb lengths. Repeat for the desired number of repetitions. Seated dumbbell press tips: keep your back flat against the pad throughout the duration of the exercise. Don't allow the head to jut forward excessively. Drive the bicep to the ear and exhale as you press. If you sense any pressure in your neck or traps during the movement, look to address a lack of thoracic spine extension or shoulder flexion. Keeping the elbows slightly bent at the top and not locking out entirely will help to keep tension on the shoulders. If you can't lock out the elbows overhead, then it may indicate a lack of shoulder mobility due to poor scapular upward rotation. Dumbbell upright row overview. The dumbbell upright row is an exercise used to build the muscles of the shoulder. It is a variation of the barbell upright row and mimics a lateral raise movement pattern. Upright rows are met with some controversy as many professionals view it as an exercise that promotes shoulder impingement. However, if performed appropriately, it can be beneficial in targeting the shoulders to promote lean muscle growth. Dumbbell upright row instructions: select the desired weight from the rack and assume a shoulder-width stance with a slightly narrower grip. Take a deep breath, then pull the dumbbells directly up the front of your body to chest height, keeping them as close as possible. Slowly lower the dumbbells back to the starting position under control. Repeat for the desired number of repetitions. Dumbbell upright row tips: keep the elbows high but don't allow the upper arm to go past parallel, as this may increase the risk of impingement. If you experience pain in the shoulders during the movement, then it may require a slight squeeze of the traps to elevate the shoulders and open up some of the subacromial space. Don't allow your back to arch as you pull the dumbbells up. Extra momentum used during the movement can potentially shift the load to other compensatory muscles, so try to limit excessive movement if possible. As you drive the elbows high, ensure the head doesn't jut forward. Dumbbell floor press overview. The dumbbell floor press is a variation of the floor press and an exercise used to strengthen the muscles of the triceps and chest. Primarily, the dumbbell floor press will target the muscles of the triceps. The limited range of motion effectively takes the chest somewhat out of the equation of the press. However, the chest can still be indirectly targeted when using the floor press. Simply focus on squeezing the pecs at the top of the movement. Floor presses, in generally, are particularly helpful for those looking to build stronger triceps to help with locking out more compound press variations. They can also be beneficial for bodybuilders trying to add mass to their triceps. Dumbbell floor press instructions begin sitting on the floor in an upright position with your legs straight and the dumbbells vertically balanced on the floor. Pick up each dumbbell and set it high in your hip crease while maintaining a tight grip. Slowly lay back while keeping the dumbbells close to your chest and bend your knees to roughly 45 degrees and move your feet up slightly. Press the weights to full extension by contracting your triceps and chest. Slowly lower the weight until both elbows touch the floor, then press both dumbbells back to the starting position. Repeat for the desired number of repetitions. To complete the exercise, simply lower the weights to the ground in controlled drop fashion. It should be a smooth motion, but not one requiring excessive effort or one that puts the shoulder under unnecessary risk. Dumbbell floor press tips maintain more tension through the pecs by not locking out the elbows entirely. Keep the weights slightly tilted at a 45-degree angle in order to keep the elbows in a neutral position. Don't allow the dumbbells to collide at the top of each rep. Bouncing them together may cause you to lose stability within the shoulder and injure yourself. Squeeze the dumbbells as tight as possible to improve a phenomenon known as irradiation, which promotes greater shoulder stability. Don't bounce the elbows off the floor at the bottom of the rep. Doing so may result in injury due to the compressive forces being generated between the weight and the floor. Ensure you maintain some tension in your abs and don't allow your lower back to excessive arch. Dumbbell flies overview. The dumbbell fly utilizes a chest fly movement pattern to isolate the muscles for the chest to better help the muscles grow and become stronger. The dumbbell fly is often thought of as a classic bodybuilding movement, as the goal of the exercise is to isolate the chest for aesthetic purposes. The movement itself can be used to help build a stronger bench press, but isn't typically thought of from an increased performance standpoint. Thus, this movement is best reserved for traditional chest workouts in bodybuilding style splits. Dumbbell flies instructions: pick up the dumbbells off the floor using a neutral grip, palms facing in. Position the ends of the dumbbells in your hip crease and sit down on the bench. To get into position, lay back and keep the weights close to your chest. Once you are in position, take a deep breath, then press the dumbbells to lock out at the top. Slightly retract your shoulder blades, unlock your elbows, and slowly lower the dumbbells laterally while maintaining the angle at your elbow. Once the dumbbells reach chest level, reverse the movement by squeezing your pecs together and bringing the dumbbells back to their starting position. Without allowing the dumbbells to touch, start the next repetition, and continue until the set is completed. Dumbbell flies tips. Imagine you're trying to hug a tree while completing the exercise. Don't squeeze the dumbbell handles excessively tight, as this can over-recruit the forearms and biceps, thereby reducing activation of the pecs. Avoid touching or banging the dumbbells together at the top of each repetition in order to keep constant tension on the intended muscle groups. Always keep a slight bend in the elbows and never lower the weight to the point where you get any sort of pain and pressure at the front of the shoulder joint. If you're feeling pain within the shoulder joint itself, specifically at the front, ensure your shoulder blades are slightly retracted and try to keep the shoulder girdle packed. Keep your feet flat on the floor, focus solely on keeping your elbows bent and activating your pecs. Ensure you maintain some tension in your abs and don't allow your lower back to excessive arch. Abdominal air bike, aka bicycle overview. The abdominal air bike is probably the most feared abdominal movement from anyone who's performed an at-home ab workout video. The bicycle exercise targets the whole abdomen and places constant tension on the midsection as you go through the motions on both sides. This exercise is an advanced variation of a crunch. It can be performed for timed sets or as a set with a fixed rep range. Abdominal air bike, aka bicycle instructions: lay supine in a relaxed position with your arms behind your head and legs straight. Exhale as you raise one knee towards your face while driving the opposite elbow to the knee. Once your abs are fully contracted, slowly lower yourself back to the starting position and repeat on the opposite side. Complete for the assigned number of repetitions. Abdominal air bike, aka bicycle tips. Exhale hard like you're blowing out candles on a cake and hold the contraction for a second in order to improve mind-muscle connection. If your lower back bothers you during this exercise, choose more anti-extension and anti-rotation based movements. Avoid putting the hands behind the head as this can lead to excess strain upon the neck. Push-up overview. The push-up is an exercise used to build the muscles of the chest. The shoulders and triceps will be indirectly involved as well. The push-up is an old-school movement that nearly everyone has performed at one point or another in their lifetime. The exercise is extremely beneficial in not only building the chest but also promoting healthy shoulder stability. You can include push-up in your chest workouts, upper body workouts, push workouts, and full body workouts. Push-up instructions: assume a quadruped position on the floor with your hands under your shoulders, toes tucked, and knees under hips. Extend one leg at a time and assume a push-up position with the legs straight, elbows extended, and head in a neutral position looking at the floor. Slowly descend to the floor by retracting the shoulder blades and unlocking the elbows. Descend until the upper arms are parallel or your chest touches the floor. Push back to the starting point by extending the elbows and driving your palms into the floor. Repeat for the desired number of repetitions. Push-up tips. Your arms should resemble an arrow in the bottom position, not a T. Your spine should remain rigid throughout the entire exercise. Think of the push-up as a moving plank. Squeeze your glutes and brace your abs before descending in order to keep the ribcage neutral. Keep the chin down and don't look forward. Imagine you're trying to push your thumbs together while completing the movement. This will improve activation of the pecs. Don't allow the head to jut forward. The chest should touch at the same time as your nose. Think about trying to push yourself as far away from the floor as possible. Ensure you push all the way through the floor at the top of the repetition and allow your shoulder blades to move around your ribcage. Most folks cut the repetition short and don't garner the full benefits as such. Straight bar tricep extension overview. The straight bar tricep extension is a variation of the cable tricep extension and an exercise used to build the muscles of the triceps. Well-built triceps also have a lot of positive carryover into your pressing movements such as bench press variations and shoulder press variations. The straight bar tricep extension can be included in your tricep workouts, upper body workouts, push workouts, and full body workouts. Straight bar tricep extension instructions: attach a straight bar to a cable stack as high as possible and assume a standing position. Grasp the straight bar with a pronated grip, palms facing down, and lean forward slightly by hinging at the hips. Initiate the movement by extending the elbows and flexing the triceps. Pull the handle downward until the elbows are almost locked out and then slowly lower under control back to the starting position. Repeat for the desired number of repetitions. Straight bar tricep extension tips. If you want to keep more tension in the triceps, don't lock the elbows out entirely. Imagine there's a screw running through your elbow and don't allow them to move in front of the body as you extend at the bottom of the movement. Experiment with static elbow positioning throughout the lift. Some may find that they get a better stretch in the bottom portion of the movement by allowing their elbows to drift behind the body during the eccentric portion of the movement, similar to a drag curl. Ensure the shoulder blades don't tilt forward as you extend the elbows. Alternating standing dumbbell curl instructions. The standing dumbbell curl is a good way to correct any strength and size imbalances in the biceps as it works each muscle individually. Set up for the exercise by grasping a set of dumbbells and standing straight up with the dumbbells by your side. Your palms should be facing up, and the dumbbells not touching your body. Before starting the set, take up the slack by lifting up the weight slightly so the tension is on your bicep muscles. Starting with your weakest arm, usually the left, curl the dumbbell up as far as possible. Squeeze the bicep at the top of the exercise, and then slowly lower the weight down without it touching your body or taking the tension off your bicep. Repeat for the other arm. That's one rep. Now repeat for the desired amount of reps to complete the set. Dumbbell curl tips. Keep the tension on both of your biceps throughout the set. Do not rest the weights on your body or let them hang down. Keep your body fixed throughout the set. No swinging back as you raise the weight. Always start with your weakest arm, for most people that will be their left. As a general rule, you should always hit your weakest side body part first. Alternate standing hammer curl instructions. The alternate hammer curl is a great exercise for the biceps and the forearms. Set up by grasping a set of dumbbells and standing straight up with the dumbbells by your sides. You should be using a neutral grip, meaning your palms are facing your body. Bend your arms slightly to keep the tension on the biceps. Keeping your body fixed and elbows in at your sides, slowly curl up the dumbbell of your weakest arm. For most people, this is their left arm. Squeeze the bicep at the top of the movement, and then slowly lower the weight back to the starting position. Repeat the same movement for the other arm. This is one rep. Now repeat to complete the set. Hammer curl tips: keep the tension on the arm that is not moving the weight. Both biceps should be tense for the entire set. Keep the rep timing slow and controlled. Always work your weakest arm first. Total of 50 burpees, and a shoulder, chest, trap, ab, and arm workout. You can always do this routine more than once if you want a longer workout. Shoulder press: hold dumbbells at shoulder level and press until arms are extended. Upright row: hold dumbbells in front of thighs and raise up to shoulder level, leading with elbows and keeping weights close to your body. Lying press: lie on your back and press dumbbells up until arms are extended over chest. Lying fly: lie on your back holding dumbbells with arm extended over chest pointing towards ceiling. Slowly lower both arms out to sides at right angles to your body, then raise back up to starting position. Pull overs: lie on back holding dumbbells at your side, raise both arms and extend over your head until dumbbells touch the floor behind you. Mason twists: lean back while sitting on floor, lift feet off ground, hold one dumbbell with both hands, extend arms and twist from side to side, touching the floor on each side as you twist. All the other exercises are pretty common and can be researched on Muscle and Strength. 30-minute full body dumbbell workout. Adding dumbbell weights to your workout routine is an excellent way to boost the amount of calories you burn, increase your muscle tone, promote bone density, and ramp up your metabolism. Even if you don't want to bulk up, everyone should aim to increase the density of their muscle mass. The benefits include: burning more calories at rest even when you're not exercising, more efficient blood flow, increasing support for joints. The ability to perform more challenging body movements, increased stamina and energy for women, less painful menstrual cycles. Combating the natural muscle diminishing that happens with age, managing chronic conditions like back pain, diabetes, obesity, and heart disease, sharpening your mental focus and clarity. Preventing osteoporosis, since stressing your bones leads to an increase in bone density. Strength training is vital to overall health and fitness for everyone, regardless of age. Don't have access to a gym? No problem. All you need is a few dumbbells at home in order to get an effective, full-body workout. Lunge and bent row: this hybrid move primarily tones your glutes and hamstrings, along with your upper back. Start upright with a dumbbell in each hand and feet shoulder width apart. With your left leg, take a large step forward and drop your bottom down so that your leg forms a 90-degree angle. While holding this position, lean your torso forward and then perform a row by clenching your back muscles, pulling your shoulder blades together, and moving your upper arms and elbows toward the ceiling. Repeat the same movement with your right leg and concentrate on driving your weight down through your heels as you come out of the lunge. Focus on keeping your chest out and your shoulders back throughout the row motion. Perform 20 repetitions, 1 lunge plus 1 row equals 1 repetition. Squat and shoulder press. The squat coupled with a shoulder press primarily strengthens your quads, hamstrings, glutes, and shoulders. Stand up with your feet shoulder width apart and a dumbbell in each hand. Drop your bottom down into a squat so that both legs are at a 90-degree angle. Push your weight down through your heels to propel your body upward. Make sure to keep your knees in line with your feet and don't let them cave inward. Don't let your toes go past the forward bend of the knees. As you come up from your squat, press both dumbbells overhead, straightening your elbows at the top. Focus on keeping your chest up, core tight, and hips forward throughout the squat motion. Move into the next rep immediately after you perform the shoulder press. Perform 20 repetitions, 1 squat plus 1 press equals 1 repetition. Sumo squat and upright row. This dynamic move targets the outside of your thighs, upper back and posterior aspect of your shoulders. Begin upright with your feet placed wider than shoulder width apart, with your toes pointing outward at a 45 degree angle. Let your arms dangle between your legs, with your dumbbells in hand. Drop your bottom down and perform a squat, keeping your feet turned outward. Focus on keeping your knees pressed outward as you come out of the squat. This isolates the outside of your thighs and prevents knee pain. As you come up, pull the dumbbells upward to chest level with elbows out and at about shoulder level. Make sure to keep your torso upright, not bent over. Perform 20 repetitions, 1 sumo squats plus 1 upright row equals 1 repetition. Dumbbell sit-ups. Dumbbell sit-ups are a great way to ramp up this traditional abdominal move. Start by lying flat on your back, feet flat on the ground, knees bent, holding the dumbbells in each hand next to your chest. Sit up, bring your torso upright, and push the dumbbells overhead, as one combined movement. Resist the urge to let momentum bring your body off of the ground. Control your body as you come back down by clenching your abdominal muscles and keeping them engaged. Perform 20 repetitions. Glute bridge and chest press. This hybrid move tones your glutes, chest, and shoulders. Begin lying flat on your back with your legs bent, feet flat on the ground, holding one dumbbell in each hand right next to your chest. Drive your weight down through your heels and elevate your hips so that they're in line with your shoulders and knees. At the same time, push the dumbbells upward directly above your chest. Bring your hips and dumbbells back down to the ground simultaneously. You can isolate your quads more by driving your weight down through your toes. Perform 20 repetitions, 1 glute bridge plus 1 chest press equals 1 repetition. This way of exercising can be highly motivating, as you are racing against the clock. The idea of ready, set, go with the clock ticking will put you into race mode and get your heart rate going immediately. To perform a 30-minute AMRAP with the moves you just learned, follow this guide. Work through this sequence as many times as you can within a 30-minute window. The takeaway: this dumbbell workout should typically be done about 3 days a week. The off days give your body time to rebuild, recover, rest, and replenish itself so that your muscles can adapt to the new demands you're placing on them. As you get stronger and more comfortable with these movements, look to increase your dumbbell weight. Neck exercises and stretches for a herniated disc. What is a herniated disc? Herniated disc, bulging disc, or slipped disc? Whatever you want to call it, this condition can be extremely painful. Herniated discs are most common in early to middle-aged adults. They're often caused when too much pressure is put on an otherwise healthy spine. The spine is composed of many bony vertebrae, separated by jelly-like discs. These discs cushion the joints during impact, allow for movement in the spine, keep the vertebrae in place. A herniated disc occurs when the soft inside of the disc, the nucleus, leaks through the tough outer portion, the annulus. This irritates the surrounding nerves. A herniated disc often occurs with movements, including lifting, pulling, bending, twisting. Bad posture and poor ergonomics may also contribute to its likelihood. When the herniated disc affects the nerves in a specific area of the spine, it can lead to pain and weakness in the area of the body that specific nerve serves. Cervical radiculopathy: if a disc herniates in the neck or upper spine, it can cause pain to radiate down the shoulder, arm, hand. This pain is called cervical radiculopathy. It's more commonly referred to as a pinched nerve. The American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons notes that cervical radiculopathy may result in feelings of burning, tingling, and weakness in the arm, shoulder, or hand. In severe cases, it may also result in loss of feeling and paralysis. Treatment: there are several treatment approaches for a herniated disc. Most doctors recommend pain medication, rest, physical therapy, and other conservative treatments before considering surgery. The following exercises may improve your neck pain from your herniated disc faster. The goal of these exercises is to push the disc back, away from the nerve root. Always have your doctor do an evaluation before attempting exercise at home. Neck exercises to relieve pain: Dr. Jose Guevara from Regional Medical Group in Atlanta recommends these exercises to relieve your neck pain. 1. Neck extension: lie on your back on a table or bed with the bottom of your neck in line with the edge. slowly and gently lower your head backward and let it hang. If this makes your pain worse, or sends pain down your arm, don't continue. Hold this position for 1 minute, rest 1 minute, and repeat 5 to 15 times. 2. Neck extension with head lift. Lie on your stomach on a table or bed with your arms by your side and head hanging off the structure. Slowly and gently raise your head up, extending your neck against gravity. Hold this position for 5 to 10 seconds. Repeat 15 to 20 times. 3. Neck retraction, chin tuck. Lie on your back with your head on the bed and hands by your side. Tuck your chin in toward your chest, making a double chin. Hold this position for 5 to 10 seconds. Repeat 15 to 20 times. 4. Shoulder retraction. Sit or stand against a wall with your arms by your side. Bend your elbows to 90 degrees. Bring your shoulders down and back and push the back of your arms toward the wall, squeezing your shoulder blades together. 5. Isometric hold. Sit up tall and relax your shoulders. Put your hand on your forehead. Press your head into your hand without moving your head. Hold this position for 5 to 15 seconds. Repeat 15 times. Neck stretches to relieve pain. Stretching may benefit people with a bulging or herniated disc. Just remember that stretching should not increase pain. If pain increases with stretching, stop immediately. For example, if a stretch causes a shooting pain down your shoulder and arm, don't perform the stretch. The goal of stretching is to relieve pain, not increase it. 1. Lateral bend. Sit up tall and relax your shoulders. Slowly tilt your head to one side as if you're going to touch your ear to your shoulder. Hold this position for 30 seconds, then rest. Repeat 3 to 5 times throughout the day. 2. Scalene stretch. Sit up tall and relax your shoulders. Grasp the chair you're sitting in with your left hand and let your shoulder blade move down. Slowly bend your right ear down toward your right shoulder and slightly backward. Hold this position for 30 seconds, rest, and repeat 3 to 5 times throughout the day. 3. Neck rotation. Sit up tall and relax your shoulders. Gently turn your head to the side. Don't over-rotate your head behind you and avoid twisting your neck. Slowly turn your head to the other side. Hold each position for 30 seconds. Repeat 3 to 5 times throughout the day. Exercises to avoid. Dr. Seth Neubart, a board-certified cervical spine surgeon, recommends avoiding any high-impact exercises while your herniated disc is healing. Exercises like running, jumping, power lifting, or anything that involves sudden sharp movements can greatly increase your pain and slow down healing. It may even cause lifelong problems. It's still possible to participate in many of your usual activities. It's important to modify challenging activities and keep your neck in a pain-free position. Gentle exercise is beneficial to the healing process. This is because it encourages increased blood flow to the spine, decreases stress, maintains strength. The takeaway. A 2009 study looked at the effectiveness of active treatment, physical therapy and home-based exercise, and passive treatment, cervical collar and rest, for cervical radiculopathy versus a wait-and-see approach. Both the active and passive treatment had a significantly positive impact on pain and disability at the 6-week follow-up versus those who didn't receive any treatment at all. This high-quality randomized control trial leaves little doubt that exercise can help heal cervical radiculopathy faster than waiting it out. What causes shoulder blade pain and how to treat it? Overview. Pain between the shoulder blades is common. Doctors refer to this discomfort as interscapular pain. People with shoulder blade pain typically have aching, dull, sore, or shooting pain in the upper part of their back between their shoulder blades. Most of the time, shoulder blade pain isn't anything to worry about. But in some cases, it can be a sign of a more serious condition. Keep reading to learn more about this common problem and how you can prevent it. Causes. There are many possible causes. Trusted source for pain between your shoulder blades. An injury to a muscle or tendon is a common reason for this type of pain. Muscle strains can result from heavy lifting, poor posture, working at a computer for extended periods of time, exercise, other activities. Sometimes, you can even strain a muscle during sleep. Injuries to other parts of your body, such as rotator cuff tears, spine fractures, or other injuries that cause trauma, can also lead to pain between your shoulder blades. Other causes for shoulder blade pain include degenerative disc disease, or a herniated or bulging disc in the spine, scoliosis, osteoarthritis in the joints around your neck, spine, or ribs, spinal stenosis, or a narrowing of your spinal cord, acid reflux, fibromyalgia, shingles, myofascial pain syndrome. Certain cancers, such as lung cancer, lymphomas, liver cancer, esophageal cancer, mesothelioma, and cancers that spread to bones, nerve compression. Gallstone, which is often accompanied by nausea and pain in the upper right part of your abdomen. Shoulder blade pain is sometimes a symptom of heart attack, especially among women. Trusted source. Other signs, such as chest pain and shortness of breath, may also be present. You should seek emergency medical treatment if you experience these symptoms. Thoracic aorta rupture or aortic dissection occurs when you have a tear or rupture in the inner layer of the large blood vessel that branches off your heart. That can cause a sharp, severe pain in your upper middle back. If this happens, you should call your local emergency services right away, as an aortic tear is considered a medical emergency. Pulmonary embolism is another serious condition that can cause shoulder blade pain. Some people report a sudden, sharp pain in their shoulder blades when blood clots in their legs break off and travel to their lungs. Shortness of breath is also a symptom of pulmonary embolism. Seek medical help right away if you think you have a pulmonary embolism. When you should see a doctor, you should see a doctor if your pain is severe, trusted source, unusual, or doesn't go away. Pain is a sign that something could be wrong. Your condition might not be serious, but if it's bothersome in any way, you may want to get it checked out. If your shoulder blade pain is accompanied by certain symptoms, it could mean you have a life-threatening condition that requires prompt medical attention. Seek help right away if you have pain between your shoulder blades, along with the following: shortness of breath, chest pain, lightheadedness, excessive sweating, pain, swelling, or redness in your legs, coughing up blood, fever, rapid or irregular heartbeat, sudden difficulty speaking, loss of vision, paralysis on one side of your body, loss of consciousness. Treatment for your shoulder blade pain will depend on the cause and severity of your condition. Recovery time will vary from person to person. Home remedies. Some people find relief from shoulder blade pain with therapies performed at home. Exercise. Physical activity is important for overall health, but exercise can also strengthen areas in your back, which may help with pain. Push-ups, pull-ups, and sit-ups are good exercises to strengthen muscles in your back and abdomen. Read more: exercises for wider shoulders. Stretching. Yoga and other stretching techniques can improve circulation to your muscles and joints, which may offer better mobility, trusted source, and pain relief. This shoulder stretch sometimes helps. Cross one arm over your body. Use your other arm to pull the elbow of your outstretched arm toward your chest. Hold this stretch for about 10 seconds. Ask your doctor about other stretches that may lessen your pain. Read more: four shoulder stretches you can do at work. Diet. Certain foods can cause trusted source inflammation in your body that could worsen your symptoms. Avoid processed foods and eat plenty of fruits and vegetables. Choosing foods high in omega-3 fatty acids, such as salmon, may also help. Rest. Sometimes, you just need rest to recover from your shoulder blade pain, especially if it's the result of an injury. Hot or cold therapy. Applying hot and cold compresses between your shoulder blades may relieve discomfort. Typically, it's best to use them for 15 minutes at a time, every 4 hours. Therapy. Massage or physical therapy may provide relief in many cases, especially if the pain is caused by overuse of your muscles or joints, or an injury. Massage therapy. A massage therapist can work on areas between your shoulder blades to relax muscle tissue. You can also purchase handheld massage devices to use at home. Physical or occupational therapy. If you have an injury or a compressed nerve, your doctor might recommend physical or occupational therapy. A therapist will help you perform certain exercises that may improve symptoms. Medications. Certain medications can help relieve pain and discomfort between your shoulder blades. These may include anti-inflammatory drugs, such as ibuprofen, Advil, Motrin IV. Sometimes, steroids are given as a pill or injection to help with pain and inflammation. Muscle relaxers and even antidepressants are also prescribed for certain conditions involving the shoulder blades. Surgery, although rare, your doctor might recommend surgery if your shoulder blade pain is severe or caused by a treatable injury. This may involve removing scar tissue or repairing tendons in your shoulder or upper back area. According to the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons, however, 90% of people with shoulder blade pain will respond to non-surgical options, such as rest, exercise, and medication. Your outlook will depend on what's causing your shoulder blade pain and the severity of your condition. Most of the time, pain between the shoulder blades is a temporary ailment that will go away with rest and proper treatment. However, the discomfort may be a lifelong problem for some people. Tips for prevention: the following measures can help prevent shoulder blade pain. Practice good posture. Try to stand and sit tall, and avoid slouching. You may want to purchase an ergonomic chair or a special pillow to help with spinal and neck alignment. Don't lift heavy items. Heavy lifting can lead to injuries, which could trigger pain between your shoulder blades. Avoid carrying heavy bags on one shoulder. If you do have to lift something, be sure to bend your knees and try not to put too much pressure on your back. Don't sit for too long. Get up and stretch frequently when you're working at a computer or desk. This can help keep muscles loose. You can also try using a standing desk. There are many options available on Amazon. Adopt healthy habits. Be sure to eat whole foods, get 7 to 8 hours of sleep each night, and exercise at least 3 days a week. A healthy lifestyle can help you feel more energetic and rested, which can help you manage pain. What temporomandibular joint (TMJ) exercises relieve pain? Understanding TMJ, you may not think about your temporomandibular joints (TMJ) much, but you use them a lot. The joints connect your jawbone to your skull. Your TMJ springs into action each time you talk, chew, and swallow. TMJ disorders occur when something goes wrong with your jaw joints and jaw muscles. Oftentimes, this happens because of a jaw injury, inflammation such as with arthritis, or overuse. TMJ disorders may cause mild to debilitating symptoms, such as pain while chewing, pain in the ear, face, jaw, and neck, clicking, grating, or popping sounds in the jaw when you open or close your mouth, locking of the jaw joint, headaches. Exercises for TMJ pain relief. It's unclear exactly how TMJ exercises may relieve pain. They're thought to help strengthen jaw muscles, stretch the jaw, relax the jaw, increase jaw mobility, reduce jaw clicking, promote jaw healing. According to one 2010 study published in the Journal of Dental Research, performing TMJ exercises increases mouth opening range more than using a mouth guard in people with TMJ disc displacement. These 9 exercises from the American Academy of Family Physicians (AAFP) and the Royal Surrey County Hospital may help relieve TMJ pain and improve the movement of your jaw joints. For some exercises, there are frequency recommendations. For exercises where frequency recommendations aren't available, ask your doctor or dentist for guidance. 1. Relaxed jaw exercise. Rest your tongue gently on the top of your mouth behind your upper front teeth. Allow your teeth to come apart while relaxing your jaw muscles. 2. Goldfish exercises. Partial opening. Place your tongue on the roof of your mouth and one finger in front of your ear where your TMJ is located. Put your middle or pointer finger on your chin. Drop your lower jaw halfway and then close. There should be mild resistance but not pain. A variation of this exercise is to place one finger on each TMJ as you drop your lower jaw halfway and closed again. Do this exercise 6 times in one set. You should do one set 6 times daily. 3. Goldfish exercises. Full opening, keeping your tongue on the roof of your mouth, place one finger on your TMJ and another finger on your chin. Drop your lower jaw completely and back. For a variation of this exercise, place one finger on each TMJ as you completely drop your lower jaw and back. Do this exercise 6 times to complete one set. You should complete one set 6 times daily. 4. Chin tucks with your shoulders back and chest up. Pull your chin straight back, creating a double chin. Hold for 3 seconds and repeat 10 times. 5. Resisted opening of the mouth. Place your thumb under your chin. Open your mouth slowly, pushing gently against your chin for resistance. Hold for 3 to 6 seconds, and then close your mouth slowly. 6. Resisted closing of the mouth. Squeeze your chin with your index and thumb with one hand. Close your mouth as you place gently pressure on your chin. This will help strengthen your muscles that help you chew. 7. Tongue up with your tongue touching the roof of your mouth. Slowly open and close your mouth. 8. Side to side jaw movement. Put a 1/4 inch object, such as stacked tongue depressors, between your front teeth and slowly move your jaw from side to side. As the exercise becomes easier, increase the thickness of the object between your teeth by stacking them one on top of each other. 9. Forward jaw movement. Put a 1/4 inch object between your front teeth. Move your bottom jaw forward so your bottom teeth are in front of your top teeth. As the exercise becomes easier, increase the thickness of the object between your teeth. Other ways to manage your TMJ pain: over-the-counter pain relievers such as ibuprofen and acetaminophen may help relieve TMJ pain. Muscle relaxers may be prescribed for severe pain. Doctors may also recommend mouth guards to prevent teeth grinding and jaw clenching, mouth guards to help realign your jaw, warm towels. Ice, no more than 15 minutes per hour and not directly on the skin, stress relief techniques to help prevent behaviors that cause jaw tension, acupuncture to relieve pressure in the affected area. Severe pain caused by damaged joints may require more invasive treatments, such as corticosteroid injections into the TMJ. Surgery may be considered as a last resort. There isn't any scientific evidence that surgical interventions for TMJ disorders are safe and effective. TMJ pain may also be managed with simple lifestyle changes. You may wish to eat a soft diet to allow the TMJ to relax, avoid chewing gum, avoid biting your nails, avoid biting your lower lip, practice good posture. Limit large jaw movements, such as yawning and singing, tips for relieving pain during dental care. If you have TMJ, it may be painful to practice basic oral hygiene. This includes brushing your teeth, flossing, and getting routine dental cleanings. The TMJ Association recommends these tips to reduce pain and help make sure your teeth and gums stay healthy. Use a soft bristle toothbrush or a sonic toothbrush. Use a rubber tip stimulator or water flosser if you can't open your mouth to floss. Add an antiseptic mouth rinse to your daily dental care regimen. Tell your dental care team if you're in pain during a dental procedure. Apply ice or heat after a dental procedure. Talk to your dentist about ways to remove plaque other than flossing. For example, they may suggest wiping your teeth with cotton gauze. The bottom line: in some cases, TMJ disorders go away on their own. If your symptoms persist, TMJ exercises may help bring pain relief. TMJ exercises shouldn't be done when you're in severe pain. The AAFP recommends waiting until your pain is better before starting a TMJ exercise regimen. When doing TMJ exercises, start slowly. You may feel some pain at first, but it should be tolerable and gradually improve. If the pain isn't tolerable, consult your doctor. You should do TMJ exercises when you're relaxed. If you do them when your muscles are tense, it may defeat the purpose. If your pain worsens after doing TMJ exercises, make an appointment with your doctor. Should you hire a virtual, online fitness coach? Hiring a personal trainer who actually motivates you to do squats and burpees sounds great in theory, but it may not be an option for you. It might not fit in your budget. They can be crazy expensive. Maybe you can't easily find time in your schedule, or you prefer the home gym you have in your garage instead of a fancy boutique workout space. A few years ago, for me it was about the money, or lack thereof. I decided that I didn't want that to stop me, however, so I hired an online coach to help take my fitness journey to the next level by training me for my first and only bikini competition. She was great, and in many ways, I credit that experience with igniting the passion I now have for health and fitness. Online training isn't for everyone, though, and some online fitness coaches aren't as great as their website makes them out to be. So how do you decide if you should take the dive into virtual training? Here's what you need to know. How an online coach works: maybe you'll have an initial consultation on the phone or via Skype to talk about your goals, or maybe you'll communicate over email or an online system. However you and your coach decide to communicate, you'll go to the gym on your own with the workouts they've created and report back on your progress. Pros of working with an online coach. Pros: working with an online coach is less expensive than an in-person coach. They can support you and help you stay on track with your fitness goals. Online training is more flexible. Perhaps the biggest pro of online fitness coaching is the cost. It won't drain the wallet nearly as much as an in-person trainer and therefore makes personal training accessible to more people. From my experience, a personal trainer in a gym can range from $60 to $75 an hour on average, depending on where you live and what gym you go to, of course. If you want to work with a trainer 3 times per week, that adds up to $720 to $900 a month. On the flip side, online coaching programs that provide 5 days worth of workouts could be as low as $200 a month. For someone who's a self-starter, an online trainer can provide a great option for accountability and guidance. If you're used to working out on your own but need help formulating a workout regimen, having a trainer to support you and report to weekly or bi-weekly can help you get and stay on the track to reach your goals. Online training is also more flexible. If you can't make it to the gym during normal hours or on a consistent schedule, or want the option to work out at home, a virtual fitness coach and plan may be for you. Plus, if you're dying to work with a trainer who lives in Los Angeles and you live in Florida, online coaching can make that possible. Cons of hiring an online fitness coach. Cons: there's no in-person help or support. There's no in-person accountability. The quality of online trainers may vary. One major con is that you get no in-person help. Maybe your squat form isn't quite perfect, or you're not familiar with what a rear delt fly is. Not having a fitness professional there in person to support you during each workout could cause frustration or even injury. Take this into account, especially if you're new to working out. An online coach also can't provide in-person accountability. If you're someone who likes the real-time interaction, you may struggle. Also, with no set session to make it to every week, it may be easier to skip a workout here or there or even slack off while exercising. There's also a gray area when it comes to certification and qualification of online trainers. If a personal trainer has been hired at a gym, they're at minimum certified through a major institution like National Academy of Sports Medicine, American Council on Exercise, or International Sports Sciences Association, follow a safe and established protocol, and have a basic understanding of how personal training should work. This doesn't guarantee they'll be good at what they do or that you'll see results, but it's a start. With an online coach, the potential for poorly executed personal training that won't help you, or that even harms you, is higher. Bottom line, should you hire an online fitness coach? There are 3 important criteria to meet when deciding if online training is right for you. You're not a complete beginner. You've done a squat or two before, and know what a superset is. You have no problems motivating yourself to get to the gym consistently. You're willing to do the extra research to understand what you should be doing and how. Yeah, what the heck is a rear delt fly anyway? Google it and watch YouTube videos before you hit the gym to ensure you're executing properly. If you can check these boxes, start your quest for an online trainer by doing research. Check out websites and Instagram accounts, read reviews, and do some initial consultations. Often, you'll be able to gauge just how serious and effective an online trainer could be for you by reading about and talking to them. Bulging discs, about that pain in your neck. You probably take your neck bones, called cervical vertebrae, for granted, but they have a significant role. Besides supporting your head, which weighs around 9 to 12 pounds, they also allow you to swivel your head a full 180 degrees. This can take quite a toll on your cervical vertebrae, the 7 most delicate bones in your spine. Knowing this, it makes sense that your neck may have problems from time to time. One of the most serious conditions involving your neck bones is a bulging disc. Them bones, if you've ever looked closely at the neck bones of a turkey or chicken, you've no doubt seen how all these small vertebral bones connect to make the spine. Muscles, ligaments, and tendons connect each vertebrae to the next. Vertebrae are ring-shaped, giving your spine a hollow canal that encases and protects the millions of nerve fibers that form your spinal cord. You have 24 total vertebrae, and the uppermost 7 are in your neck. The top part of your spine is the cervical spine. Below it is the thoracic spine, and below the thoracic spine is the lumbar spine. These three sections of your spine, along with the sacrum and coccyx, tailbone, below the lumbar region, form your spinal column. What is a bulging disc? Between each vertebrae is a gel-filled disc that acts as a shock absorber and helps the spine move. A damaged disc may bulge, pushing backwards into the spinal canal. The disc usually bulges toward one side of the canal, either right or left, which is why people with a bulging disc are likely to have pain and tingling on just one side of the body. A bulging disc in your neck may be relatively painless. Or it can cause severe pain in your neck, as well as your shoulders, chest, and arms. It may also cause numbness or weakness in your arms or fingers. Sometimes, this pain and numbness may even cause you to think that you're having a heart attack. Some people incorrectly use the terms bulging disc and herniated disc interchangeably. A herniated disc is a fully ruptured disc. Bulging discs can eventually become herniated discs. Causes of bulging discs: spinal discs absorb a lot of wear and tear. Over time, they start to degenerate and weaken. Degenerative disc disease is the most common cause of bulging discs, often resulting in spinal osteoarthritis. Other factors that can cause or contribute to bulging discs include strain or injury, obesity, smoking, poor posture and activity. How are bulging discs diagnosed? If you have pain that could be from a bulging or herniated disc, your doctor will give you a physical exam. You're also likely to have one or more imaging tests. These include spinal X-rays, computed tomography scans, CAT scan or CT scan, and magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, scans. Your doctor may recommend an electromyogram, EMG, to check the condition of affected nerves. Treatment options: fortunately, there are several ways to treat a bulging disc. Conservative treatment is also called non-operative management. It includes rest and medications and is often enough to heal a bulging cervical disc. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, NSAIDs, such as ibuprofen are the first-line prescription medications for a bulging disc. For more severe pain, your doctor may prescribe a muscle relaxer or narcotic pain reliever. Physical therapy, PT, may relieve pressure on the nerve. At-home traction devices can ease pressure on the nerve. Cortisone injections, known as epidural steroid injections, or ESI, into the spine can provide longer-term relief. Various surgical procedures treat cervical herniation. However, only about 10% of people with bulging discs ultimately require surgery. Fixing upper back and neck pain. Overview: upper back and neck pain can stop you in your tracks, making it difficult to go about your typical day. The reasons behind this discomfort vary, but they all come down to how we hold ourselves while standing, moving, and, most important of all, sitting. Neck and upper back pain can limit your movements and capabilities. If you don't do anything about your pains, they can get worse, spread, and limit you further. This is usually because the muscles around your immediate area of pain have tensed up to protect that one spot. That expansion limits movement and can turn one clenched muscle under your shoulder blade into a painful shoulder and a tension headache. Causes of upper back and neck pain include improperly lifting something heavy, practicing poor posture, sports injury, being overweight, smoking. Our love of screens is also a likely culprit in upper back and neck pain. Sitting all day working on a computer screen, craning your neck to read the news on your phone on the way home, and slumping on the couch to watch several hours of television are great ways to throw your body out of alignment. Like many health conditions, the effects of neck and back pain can be more severe in people who smoke or are overweight. Excess weight can add more pressure on the muscles. Quick relief and prevention: chronic upper back and neck pain can become a very serious problem. However, some general soreness in your back and neck area is quite common. There are a few measures you can take for quick relief when this discomfort arises, and some things you can do to try to prevent it altogether. Use a cold pack and anti-inflammatory pain relief for the first 3 days after the pain starts. After that, alternate applying heat and cold to your injury. Upper back and neck pain usually erupt suddenly, but healing can take a long time. If you're still in pain and your movement is limited after a month, it's time to see your doctor. Apply a cold compress if you can. Apply a cold compress. This could mean a handful of ice in a plastic bag wrapped in a towel, or anything cold, such as a soda, can right out of the machine. Try an over-the-counter pain reliever if your stomach tolerates non-steroidal anti-inflammatory meds such as naproxen. Take them according to package directions as soon as you can. Walk upright. Walking with healthy posture could help as well. A good way to visualize healthy posture is to imagine you are suspended by a line connecting the middle of your chest to the ceiling or sky. Stretches. Once you've calmed the immediate pain and rested your injury for a day or so, you can begin trying to loosen it and help heal it through stretches. Any of these stretches will also help you prevent new pain or prevent a reoccurrence of an old injury. Eye pose. Sitting in a firm chair or on an exercise ball with your feet flat on the ground, allow your hands to hang straight down from your relaxed shoulders. With your palms facing each other, slowly lift your hands toward your knees, then all the way over your head. Keep your elbows straight but not locked, and don't lift your shoulders. Hold the eye pose for 3 deep breaths, then slowly lower your arms back to your sides. Repeat 10 times. W pose. Stand against a wall with your feet shoulder width apart. Begin with your arms dangling at your sides and your shoulders relaxed. Put your arms out like Frankenstein, then pull your elbows back to the wall next to your ribcage. Next, try to bring the backs of your hands and your wrists to the wall to the sides of your shoulders. You're making the shape of a W, with your torso as the center line. Hold it for 30 seconds. Do 3 rounds, at least once and up to 3 times per day. Head tilt. This simple exercise is likely the hardest to perform early on in your injury. Don't push yourself too much, it should become easier over time. Sitting in a firm chair or on an exercise ball with your feet flat on the ground, allow your arms to hang straight down from your relaxed shoulders. Keeping your arm at your side, grasp the seat of your chair with your right hand, and tilt your left ear toward your left shoulder. Extend as far as you can comfortably, and hold for 1 deep breath. Repeat 10 times, then grasp with your left hand and stretch toward the right 10 times. Back pain and sleep. Back and muscle pain can also interfere with your sleep. According to the National Sleep Foundation, in your deepest stages of sleep, your muscles relax. This is also the time when your body releases human growth hormone. When you lose sleep due to back or neck pain, you lose this opportunity to heal. Basic full body workout you can do at home. This total body home workout is perfect for working the entire body with no muss, no fuss. All you need are a few sets of dumbbells and these basic exercises. All of these moves will hit the major muscles of your body, including the chest, back, shoulders, arms, legs, and abs in a short period of time. It includes all the classic exercises and can be done in a short period of time. This is a great workout option when you are crunched for time, but still want to get the job done. Total body home workout with dumbbells. Precautions. See your doctor before trying this workout if you have any injuries, illnesses, or other conditions. Equipment needed: various weighted dumbbells, a bench or step, you can use the floor if you don't have one. How to. Beginners, start with no weight or light weights and do one set of 14 to 16 reps of each exercise. Intermediate, advanced, do 2 to 3 sets of 8 to 12 reps with enough weight that you can only complete the desired number of reps. Warm up with 5 minutes of light cardio or warm up versions of each exercise. Substitute or skip any exercises that cause pain or discomfort. Chest press. Your total body workout begins with the chest press, one of the best ways to work your chest. While the move primarily targets these muscle area, it also works the shoulders and triceps with this exercise, making it a great compound move. How to: lie on a bench or step and hold dumbbells up over your chest. Bend the elbows and lower the weights until your elbows are at about 90 degree angles. They should look like goal posts at the bottom of the movement. Press the weights back up and repeat. Lower and repeat for 1 to 3 sets of 8 to 16. Helpful tip: the chest is a larger muscle group, so you can usually go a little heavier with this exercise, depending on how much experience you've had doing it. One arm row you've worked your chest, now it's onto the next big upper body muscle group, the back. The one arm row works the lats, the big muscles on either side of your back. As a bonus, you'll also get plenty of biceps work in there as well. How to: place the left foot on a step or platform and rest the left hand or forearm on the upper thigh. Hold a weight in the right hand, tip forward keeping the back flat and the abs in, and hang the weight down towards the floor. Bend the elbow and pull it up in a rowing motion until it is level with the torso or just above it. At the top of the movement, squeeze the back. Lower and repeat for all reps before switching sides. Lower and repeat for 1 to 3 sets of 8 to 16. Challenge yourself. The lats are a large muscle group and can usually handle heavier weight. Choose a weight that really challenges you for this exercise, usually between about 8 to 20 pounds for women and 15 to 35 pounds for men. Overhead press next in your total body workout, as your shoulders, which may already be a little warm from the chest presses you did earlier. If you want strong, firm shoulders, overhead presses should be your first choice. They target both the mid and front deltoid, making it a great overall move. How to: stand with feet about hip distance apart, holding weights at ear level with the elbows bent like goal posts. Press the weights up and overhead while keeping the abs braced and avoiding arching the back. Lower and repeat for 1 to 3 sets of 8 to 16 reps. Watch your technique. Avoid lowering the arms way down past the shoulders, which takes emphasis off the shoulders and is a way to cheat. Watch yourself in the mirror and make sure you're keeping that goalpost shape every time. Hammer curls on one leg. I love hammer curls for working the biceps and, as an added bonus, you can work on your balance by doing them while standing on one leg. It's harder than it looks. How to: hold weights in both hands, palms face in, and lift the right foot off the ground, holding that position, if you can. Now, curl the weights up towards the shoulders, palms still facing in and squeezing the biceps. Lower and repeat for 1 to 3 sets of 8 to 16 reps. Control is key. Avoid swinging the weights, which adds momentum to the exercise. Instead, make the move slow and controlled so you're using all your muscle fibers to lift that weight. Kickbacks. No total body workout is complete without working the triceps, that lovely area at the back of the arms that tends to, shall we say, continue waving long after we've waved hello? Now, you can do this move one arm at a time, which I like. But I really like doing it with both arms because you get some great core work with this one, and I'm all about multitasking. Just make sure you bend the knees and brace the abs to support your lower back. How to: bend at the waist, keeping the back flat and the abs engaged, and pull the elbows up to the torso. There should be weights in your hands, of course. Holding that position, straighten the arms and squeeze the triceps muscles. Lower and repeat for 1 to 3 sets of 8 to 16 reps. Try this variation if you find your back bothers you. Bend the knees or prop one knee on a bench and do this move one arm at a time. Keep the elbow next to the torso the entire time and don't let it drift down as you get tired. Pretend like you're holding an envelope in your armpit. Deadlifts. Deadlifts are one of the most challenging exercises to learn to do correctly, but I love this move for transitioning into the lower body portion of the workout. Not only does it target the glutes and hamstrings, it also works your lower back as well, a complement to the one-arm row exercise you did earlier. How to: stand with feet hip-width apart and hold weights in front of thighs. Tip from the hips and lower weights towards the floor, back flat and shoulders back. Return to start and repeat for 1 to 3 sets of 8 to 16 reps. Don't slouch, keep the shoulders throughout the entire exercise. It's tempting to round your back with this move, which only puts your lower back at risk for injury. Squats. Squats are probably one of the most important exercises in any strength routine, especially a total body workout. This functional exercise helps you work on all the muscles you use each day to sit, stand, walk, basically do just about any lower body movement you do in a day. How to: hold weights in each hand and stand with feet about hip distance apart. Bend the knees and lower into a squat, knees behind the toes and squatting as low as you can. Push back to start and repeat for 1 to 3 sets of 8 to 16 reps. Helpful tip: think of sending your butt back behind you when you squat, putting the emphasis on your glutes and thighs instead of on the knees. Lunges. If you want to get the most out of your total body workout, lunges fit the bill. They work multiple muscle groups, which means you work your body with fewer exercises, thus saving time and getting more out of your workout. How to start with your feet about hip width distance. Step 1, back and drop your knee low to the ground. Lift back up and repeat before switching sides. 1 to 3 sets of 8 to 16 reps. If lunges hurt your knees, try one of these alternatives to lunges. Bicycle. If you want to really target your abs, the bicycle crunch is the way to go. This move works every muscle of the abs, with an emphasis on the obliques. How to lie on the floor and bring the knees into the chest. Straighten the right leg as you twist the body, bringing the right elbow towards the left knee. Repeat on the other side in a cycling motion. Repeat for 1 to 3 sets of 8 to 16 reps. If you find bicycles a bit tough for you, try this bicycle modification. Please like, share, comment and subscribe this video. Thanks for watching my video.